The following feature presentation is brought to you by the Time Warp Cinema and is rated A for awesome. The Time Warp Cinema contains some adult language, a few spoilers, and some adult scenarios. We recommend caution while listening, and if you take life too seriously, please adjust your outlook. The Time Warp Cinema is for entertainment use only and has no bearing on real life. So please, sit back, relax, and enjoy the show.
It's astounding. Time is fleeting. Madness takes its toll. But listen closely.
Not for very much longer.
I've got to keep control.
Hello and welcome to the Time Warp Cinema Podcast. I'm your host and time-traveling cinephile Jay, and joining me as always are my three faithful companions, Tom.
P.A. Isu Domine.
Grant.
What?
And Andy.
Howdy.
Every 2 weeks we take a trip into the movie's past as we enter the Time Warp Cinema. This week we went back to 1975 for the cult comedy classic Monty Python and the Holy Grail. We'll also be discussing our favourite Kurt Russell performances. And remember, if you'd like to join in the discussion on these or any other film-related topics, you can find us on Twitter at timewarp_cinema. And if you like what you hear, you can always subscribe and leave a review for us. So, without further delay, let's just get on with the show.
Let's do the time warp.
Before we get to our main feature, we first have time to answer this week's big question. And this week, Tom asked what our three favourite Kurt Russell performances were. So we'll start with you then, Tom, being as this is your question.
Well, my first one, shouldn't be any bit of a surprise to you. My first choice is Stargate.
Expected it.
Yeah,
expected
match.
Match for myself as well. That was my number two pick.
I do not have that one. Yay, I'm original.
Bollocks, are you?
No, I'm going to be last today, and I expect all of my choices to have gone before I get a chance to properly
That's
speak.
Entirely probable.
Yeah.
Entirely possible. I'm a big sci-fi fan. Stargate is a really great science fiction film, which also delves into ancient sort of cultures with the Egyptians. So you kind of got this sort of polar opposites from the film, which play off really well, and Kurt Russell just plays a great role in it.
Well, Kurt Russell is basically your typical military, by-the-book tough guy.
It's obviously a role he's quite suited to, and
very much so.
The first time or last time that he did that role.
No. He pulls it off really well.
Of course he does. Obviously, we did once review it when we did that other podcast that we tend not to mention now.
Yeah.
Although you can still find it if you go back.
It was a good film. Obviously, it must have been a really good film because it spawned the TV series.
Several TV series.
Yeah, but let's be honest. You don't need to have a good film to spawn off a great TV show, Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
This is true, but it helps.
It does help when the film originally was great, because I was shocked when they did do Buffy, so...
Well, yeah.
Did you know that they actually preserved the haircut, the buzz cut he had in that film, to use as a diamond cutter?
What?
He has a buzz cut, the sharpest buzz cut you have ever seen. Like, it literally cuts diamonds. It's awesome.
He plays the military archetype very well. Mm. And that sort of brings me nicely onto my second choice, which is a role that came after Stargate, which is a 1996 film, Soldier.
Are we just going through all the old films that you made us watch for the old podcast?
Maybe.
Yeah. Mm. Okay, Soldier. Anybody else pick that, Nate?
Nope.
He plays a very similar role in Soldier, where he's the raised from birth.
Well, he's got less personality.
Yeah.
Because he's like a indoctrinated, raised from birth in a contained environment to be the perfect soldier.
To be quite honest, that would have been a perfect role for Dolph Lundgren at the time.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's true.
Because Kurt Russell has a lot more acting ability than just being the grunt that he was playing in that movie. Kurt Russell actually started off in Disney films, if anybody was interested in that.
Well, I think actually some of what he does in Soldier is a testament to his skill, because he doesn't have very many lines in the film, but he actually gives you a hell of a lot of emotion with his facial expressions and the looks in his eye. And some of the delivery gives with some the few of those lines that he does actually have.
Not an easy thing to do, even for a trained actor.
No, that's true.
No.
All right, okay, and your third pick?
Sky High.
Great film that just came out of nowhere.
I love that film. It's just so funny. It's comedy, it's light, it's... You get to see Kurt doing some of the comedy sketches of this, which harkens back to a little bit through some of his early work.
Yeah, and it's obviously a different role than the previous two you mentioned.
Yeah.
He's the sort of eager dad.
Bit too ego.
Yeah, a bit of macho-y, ego-y dad, but still a nice...
Given
you can see
as well,
he's still a nice guy as well. He's not like over-the-top egotistic or anything.
He plays that part very well. Obviously, last time we did a movie marathon, it was your pick for that, and he does play the archetype, just superhuman.
Yeah, superhuman strong guy.
Superman type.
Yeah.
Very well. He looks the part with that big chin that we mentioned earlier.
I have to mention this now. It's not come up already. He's got great hair.
Yeah. He does.
Damn, does he have good hair.
I'm jealous. I'm so jealous.
How do you get your hair like that? It must be at least one can of hairspray. Surely.
I've got no idea, but during the week, while researching some Kurt Russell movies myself, just to refresh myself on what they were, I was sitting caricaturing him as Snake Plissken, which I'm not going to go into just in case. And it was all jaw and hair. That was basically it. It was just jaw and hair. I showed Tom the caricature, instantly recognised him.
Nice.
That's Kurt Russell. It's just all hair and jaw and...
His hair is just so talented.
He is amazing.
Obviously he's most well known for the long...
The long locks.
The long lion's mane of a hairdo. But as we've just said, in like Stargate and stuff, he rocks
the buzz cut.
Amazing buzz cut as well.
Yeah. Okay. He just looks good.
He does, yeah. It probably helps, doesn't it?
Is there a bit of a four-way man crush going on there?
I really do think there could be.
I mean, Walt Disney fucking loved him as well. Yeah. Like I say, he was originally a contract actor for Disney, and apparently Walt Disney's last words were Kurt Russell.
Nice.
There is more to that story than I'm saying. Apparently, it's a lot more complicated than that. But how fucking freaky would that be to be Walt Disney's last words?
That would be quite unnerving and awesome.
When you say last words, in what sense? Like his deathbed?
I don't know. As I say,
like the death rattle last words, like. Kurt Russell.
are we all thinking Rosebud now?
No, actually.
No? Oh, well, I was. But no, I don't know. As I said, there's a lot more to that story, but the basics of it is that apparently Walt Disney's last words were Kurt Russell.
An official endorsement of Kurt Russell.
Yeah.
For Disney. Kurt
which,
Russell.
Which everyone should give, let's be honest.
I would put that on my CV.
Or Kurt Russell murdered Walt Disney.
Yeah,
and
that's where my episode went.
Yeah, maybe that's what it is, and this isn't an amazing thing Disney was just trying to tell us.
Nah, not buying.
That's one for you conspiracy theory nuts. So those were your choices?
They were my three, yeah.
Yep. Grant, we've had one of yours. What are your other two?
One was Stargate. My third choice is Escape from New York.
Yeah. Okay, Snake Plissken.
Again, going back to the heart, like tough guy, Rambo-y, action-y, 80s sort of character stereotype. I might as well mention it now. And the character Solid Snake from the Metal Gear Solid games.
Very, very subtly influenced by
him. Yeah, subtly influenced by this character for about a dozen games over the last 25 years.
Yeah,
thereabouts.
The core, raw awesomeness of Snake Plissken as this ridiculously macho, tough, hard man who can just be dropped into any situation
with a
ridiculous-looking gun with all sorts of crap attached to it that is just either in the way or in reality would do nothing. And, you know, complete the mission.
Yeah, dropped into New York to save the president. Saves the president because that's the kind of guy he is.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Just beats the big guy in the wrestling ring by smacking his skull in with a nail through a baseball bat.
Yeah, I'll tell you where on that one because I can't remember.
Yeah, no, he does. And Chef from South Park is the main baddie.
Was he?
Hayes. Yeah.
Oh, I forgot that. Baron or something, wasn't it?
We're going to kill the president, children.
Yeah, that was my third choice. My first choice is actually the greatest film of all time, Big
Willy
Trouble.
Wonka, I can't remember him in that.
Sacrilege. It is actually Big Trouble in Little China.
Of course it is, and that's a match. Yeah. And that is a match.
I am surprised that Tom didn't pick that, actually.
As awesome as the film is, not more about top three.
Well, obviously, otherwise it would have been in your choice.
Exactly.
But you've got a three-way match anyway.
Yeah. To the surprise of no one, this is possibly my favourite film of all time.
You once wrote a blog about it when you heard there was a remake. So, yeah, yes, we knew. Yeah.
This film has everything. It has action, it has monsters, it has magic. It has kung fu, it has ninja gangs.
From the look of it, it very much influenced the game Mortal Kombat, which I fucking love.
Yes, yeah. Very possibly.
I've never seen any confirmation of that, but there is too many similarities.
It's just one of those films where things start pretty quickly. It's not an escalation like to a big battle or anything, but just something's always happening and it's like, oh wow, cool. With like, you know, David Lopan, the magic.
Kim Cattrall. The 80s. It had to have Kim Cattrall.
Of course.
Oh, yes.
It was too adult to have Elizabeth Shue or Molly Ringwald. That was basically it. If your film was slightly adult, you had to have Kim Cattrall. And why not? Because she was fucking hot back then.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
She was in her prime at the time.
Prime at the time.
Yeah.
That should be a new segment on the podcast. Prime at the time. 1986. Yeah. Who was at the best?
We might get a few people writing in about us being sexist there.
We only have a few people listen. That wouldn't be very good.
That's the entire audience.
But yeah, no, Jack Burton in... What can you not say about Big Trouble in Little China?
It's awesome, and that's the only thing you should have to say about it.
Other than it's a kids' film. It's not really a kids' film.
It's got everything.
Well, again, and trucks.
The story in that is Kurt Russell's just a regular guy. He's the lead role in the film, but the story's going to happen regardless of whether he was coming into town or not.
Yeah, he's the hero of the story, but he's not a hero.
Yeah.
He's just a trucker with a cheeky slash bad attitude who gets caught up in things. And
completely out of his depth.
Completely out of his depth. And every scene, things just get more and more ridiculous.
Yeah.
When he Lopan first appears in that street after he witnesses a gang war and people getting like chopped to shreds, and then the three thunder gods come down, like seeing the magic, and then Lopan appears, tries to run him over, one thing after another.
I think it starts off just bloody brilliant, though, and ends in the same kind of way.
It starts off on a dark and stormy night.
Yeah, but with Kurt Russell in his truck, talking into his CB radio, and like basically narrating his life because he is that much of a fucking egotist. Everyone must know what's going on in Jack Burton's life. And
well, that was the Twitter of its day.
Yeah,
getting on the CB,
taking photos of his food,
and then film ends the same way.
Yeah,
he's in his truck on the CB,
And then there's a little critter underneath.
Not little.
Well,
the big critter. Yeah, the monster had snuck onto his truck.
God, that is a good film. Why haven't we watched that and reviewed it for podcast?
I don't know.
We've done it in a movie marathon. We did it in a movie marathon once. We've not reviewed it for the podcast.
Yeah, it may have to be a pick.
It will have to be a pick. It's definitely on my list, but then again, I've got a list that's long enough to keep this podcast going for the next 6 years.
You'd have a bit of a list, yes.
A bit of a list.
So those were all three of yours.
Yep. That's
wow, and I'm shocked because it looks like
you've only had one so far.
Yeah,
so far, haven't you?
Yeah, and you've had two, so I'm definitely going to have to speak at least once.
Yeah,
fuck me speaking. It's just never going to happen.
That's right. You can edit yourself out.
obviously we've had Stargate and Big Trouble, and my third pick is The Thing.
Yay, that's a crossover.
Hey!
Of course it is.
It had to be, didn't it, really?
It did. Fantastic film, holds up ridiculously well to this day. Special effects, a little bit dated, but work for what it is.
They serve their purpose so well.
Exactly, that's the thing. It's kind of what it doesn't show you.
Yeah. I was saying this to Jay when we were talking about it the other day. Most of the animatronics and the practical effects hold up really well. The only place I thought it really sort of ages is the final, like, large monster. Doesn't quite hold up. The smaller stuff looks fantastic. It's just so visceral, like, and gory. Everything looks wet and slimy, like it really was on set. Yeah. Wet and slimy and ugh.
In those days, it generally would have been a lot harder to pull off big monsters anyway, and without it looking a little bit hokey. His performance is not... It's actually relatively subtle now.
It is. It's very subtle.
He doesn't play a big action or big sort of... character part, but it shows him dialing it back.
He's just a sensible guy who they all trust at the beginning. But obviously with what goes on in the thing, and I'm sure we can fucking spoil this movie. It was made...
It's pretty... I think we're okay, yeah.
Even the sequel's like five or six years old now.
Yeah. It's an alien taking other people's bodies.
Yeah, and nobody knows who's been infected, who hasn't been infected. So he's managing to keep his head the whole time. Everybody else is getting paranoid, as they will, and other people are just turning out to be aliens.
That's one of the creepiest things. You don't even know yourself if you're infected. It's not just the paranoia about everybody else.
That's kind of the worst part, yeah.
When the people change or when the thing erupts from their body, up until a few seconds, they didn't know that they were a thing or they were infected.
No, and obviously it ends with the last two survivors, one of whom is almost guaranteed to be the thing.
Yep.
Neither of them knowing who it was, neither of them trusting the other one, basically just sitting down, having a drink and preparing to die.
Cheery.
It's not a happy ending.
No, absolutely not. And it is strongly implied that it's ultimately a victory for the thing organism.
Oh, absolutely.
Because it can survive being frozen. So it's just going to wait until a rescue party shows up, whenever that is, and infect them.
And spread, yeah.
So despite everything, you know, they tried to do to save themselves and protect anyone else, they failed.
Yeah, and just to point out, this is definitely on my list of 6 years worth of podcasts. It's definitely going to come up at one point. But like you say, Kurt Russell in it has quite a subdued role. But I think it's helped by the fact that everybody else in that film plays it brilliantly as well.
Yeah.
He's like the anchor of the whole group.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he doesn't lose his cool in the entire film.
Everybody else gets to go bananas. Yeah. He's the guy who's keeping everything calm.
Like, most of the guys are panicking because they're in a life or death situation. The scientist guy, he's terrified because he starts to truly comprehend the ramifications of what the thing is and what it could do to the whole planet.
Oh, well, he goes through the whole computer simulation and how long it would take to basically lose the entire planet to this thing.
Yeah, and then he goes out and sabotages the helicopter and the radio and everything. So he's terrified, like, you know, screw us.
He's trying to contain.
Yeah, we're dead. Right, accept that and move on. I'm fucking terrified about everybody else on Earth, like maybe my family back home or whatever.
As I say, I just love the film. Holds up so well to this day. You know, it's still the jump scares when they do the test with the blood. You know, it makes me jump.
I think it's one of the greatest horror films of all time.
Absolutely. Definitely
got to rank up there.
As I say, definitely ranks up there and never really overplays its hand.
No.
It doesn't show you too much, which a lot of horror films unfortunately have the tendency to do these days. So that was your three.
It was.
Wow, I'm actually shocked that we've got to me and that I get to say one that nobody else has picked, and I'm surprised nobody else picked it, Grant. I would have thought this one would have been on your list. Ego from Guardians of the Galaxy 2.
Great character. Shows up completely unexpected as well.
Absolutely. We reviewed Guardians for the old podcast. It was the film that we said we basically forgot that we were meant to be critiquing it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is not a common occurrence for us.
It never happens for us now. We can't watch a film now that we're not meant to be critiquing without...
Well, that's sitting there and going, that wouldn't happen.
Yeah. but no, this was one of those times when we sat in the cinema and completely forgot that we was meant to be reviewing this film. And one of the main reasons for that was Kurt Russell as Ego. And just his entrance into the film, basically surfing on a spaceship, wiping out an entire battalion of...
battle probes, I mean.
Battle probes, yeah. And just looking so fucking cool.
Awesome,
doing
yeah.
It. He's doing it, which in itself is cool, but then he's just looking so fucking badass doing it.
Well, he's holding like a rail or something, isn't he? Yeah. And he's got that pose. It's just reminiscent of, like, you know, riding, you know, like the cowboy riding into town or whatever, just completely chill.
What it reminded me of was the old... When you watch films like set in Rome and the chariot races and like that kind of poses, he's ready with a weapon, although he wasn't ready with a weapon, and he's just there, and it's like, yeah, I've won. Here I am. It had been a while since I'd really seen Kurt Russell in anything up till that point. I know he's done a few things more recently. He played Santa on Netflix at Christmas, but he just nailed it. From start to finish in that role, playing Living Planet Ego, Star-Lord's dad. And he was charming and psychopathic. And
that was what was good, the development of the character throughout the film. When he shows up, he's laying on the charm nice and thick.
Yeah, Chris Pratt as Star-Lord is like, I found my daddy! Yay! And they play catch.
Quill's like super happy to, you know, randomly meet his father. But then the cracks start to appear. Slowly throughout the film progresses to the egotistical
megalomaniac.
Megamaniacal.
Megamaniacal
celestial who wants to basically consume the entire universe.
And it turns out he's been killing all of his kids who haven't quite lived up to...
They didn't inherit his power. So he was basically breeding non-stop.
Obviously, we then go into the whole Yondu storyline. And you may be your father, but I'm your daddy. I'm Mary Poppins, y'all. Oh, dear.
Best line in the film.
Absolutely.
Best moment is Chris Pratt's face, the expression when he says, yeah, he's cool.
Yeah.
Just giving Yondu the win there.
Yeah.
But this whole scheme, because it turns out that Yondu had been collecting all of Ego's children.
He'd been hired by Ego to collect kids, yeah.
And this is what got him kicked out of the...
Ravagers.
Yeah.
Something like that.
And once Yondu had found out what Ego was doing with his kids, was the reason that Yondu had kept hold of Star-Lord. And spoilers for anyone who hasn't seen Guardians of the Galaxy 2, but fucking hell, you should have by now.
Yeah.
You should have listened to our really review and then gone out and watched it straight away.
Exactly.
It was just so fun. I had to pick it over... You know, Escape from New York and Tango and Cash, which I'm surprised didn't get mentioned.
Nearly.
Close for me as well.
Yeah, I was just watching that this afternoon, getting myself back into it, but...
Because it's awesome.
It is a good film. Opposite story.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, Ego, Thing, and Big Trouble in Little China for me. So that was your question, Tom. So next time we'll fall on Grant.
Okay, my choice is Brad Pitt.
Brad Pitt.
Cool.
Good call. Good call. That's going to be a tough one for me because I'm a real fan of...
That's why... Well, it's part of the reason I picked it. He's done a lot of good films.
So that will be next time on The Big Question, our favourite Brad Pitt performances.
It's just a jump to the left. With your hands on your hips.
It's now time to fire up the time circuits and take a trip back to 1975 as we revisit the cult comedy classic Monty Python and the Holy Grail. Starring the cast of Monty Python's Flying Circus, the Holy Grail is a comedic take on the legend of King Arthur and loosely tells the story of his quest to find the titular grail. And obviously, being this is our podcast, I want to give you some facts about the film before we get into it. So, fact number one! The French tactic of pelting Arthur and his knights with livestock echoes the relatively modern legend of medieval siege of the fortified southern French town of Carcassonne, where they were said to have been near starvation. The townspeople used the last of their food to pelt the besieging army to convince them, basically
they could last out because they'd got plenty of supplies. Mm.
And it worked.
You're kidding me.
Yep.
That sounds like the stupidest bluff in history.
Yeah. But it worked. The invading army realised if they can throw cares at us, we're going to be here forever trying to get in. So they buggered off.
Oh my God, that commander was stupid.
They had really good poker faces. They really did.
That's it.
I'm just trying to picture that in my head. Like
you won't meet, you know, you go to a poker table anyway and you meet a guy from Carcassonne, don't play him.
I'm guessing there were, you know, the details and the factors involved here are probably more...
Probably,
complicated,
yeah.
Like this, there was dissent within the siege people.
Possibly.
Already there was, you know, a lot of them wanting to go home or give up already.
Yeah, they'd probably been riding for a while.
Yeah, maybe this was just a pretext for, you know, other people within the sieging army to say, all right, fuck this, let's go.
Yeah, I didn't do that much research into it because...
What? But our new historical podcast.
Exactly. We don't do a historical podcast. We do a film.
There's plenty of other things to do historical stuff, so, you know.
Mm. Okay, that was the first fact, which seems to have Grant's interest.
More than the film.
More than the film, yeah.
Oh.
Oh.
Oh, spoilers. We haven't got to whether we enjoy the film or not yet.
Shots fired already.
Right, okay. During one of the first screenings of the film in front of a live audience, director Terry Jones noticed that when the music was played during jokes, there was a marked reduction of laughter from the audience. So he went back and edited out all the music while the punchlines were hitting. And apparently it did improve reception of the jokes, and he used that in all of his later film work.
You talking about just the music or the singing as well?
We know you don't like songs.
Yeah.
We can get to it.
Well, I was going to go on about that, but
we'll get to it.
At a later time.
you will. No, basically, if there was music playing over the punchline of a joke, people didn't laugh at it as much.
They basically thought there was a continuation to it.
Yeah.
Ah.
Which is why they weren't laughing. Mm. So what he did, he took the music out to signify that actually was...
Yeah, that's the joke.
That's the joke. Laugh. If you're going
to
laugh.
If I'd known that, I might have actually known when some of the jokes were supposed to end now. If only you'd told me this before I watched the film.
Blame Andy. It's his choice.
I think it's good that they needed to be signified when the jokes were. In a comedy, that is really good.
70s, man.
What would your comedy workshop say about that? You need a physical cue to the audience so that they know, that was the joke.
I'm actually thinking of doing that every time, like build up to it. Right, punchline!
Or having a laugh now sign.
Yeah.
But something less subtle.
Applause.
Just as I'm doing the punchline, I will just hold up a sign that says, punchline.
You mean you're not going to doff the flat cap to us in a subtle manner?
When was the last time you saw me wearing a flat cap?
He's not the flat cap crusader anymore.
When was the last time you saw him being subtle?
Well, this is also true.
When have I ever been subtle? Anyway, fact number 3. During the witch hunt, Eric Idle bares his teeth and bites down on the blade of a scythe he is holding. This was not scripted. Basically, he's trying to stop himself from laughing.
Yeah. I read something about this. John Cleese has a line in that, and he, throughout all the takes, he kept varying his timing, so sort of keeping everyone on edge. And that particular take, he'd gone for quite a long pause. But yeah, they're constantly trying to stop themselves from corpsing from each other's lines.
Well, I'm glad someone found this amusing, because I didn't. Yeah, we're not being subtle here, are we?
No.
Was that all the facts?
Yeah, no, that's not all the facts.
No, still got two
five, more. That was fact number 5.
That was fact number 3. Yeah.
Three.
It just seemed like you were going into the main thing there.
No, I'm just noting the fact that we're not very good at hiding the fact when we don't like a movie, are we? Fact number 4. I actually found this one very interesting. Funds earned by Pink Floyd's album The Dark Side of the Moon went towards funding Monty Python and the Holy Grail. The band were such fans of the show, they would halt recording sessions just to watch Monty Python's Flying Circus. And Led Zeppelin and Genesis also contributed funds towards the budget.
Wow.
We had some major band backing going on there.
Yeah.
That's how they got the funding, really, was bands and...
Well, that's it.
Pretty cool.
They were on a very tight budget.
Something like $250,000 they wound up costing?
Couldn't tell you.
Not to be too nitpicky, but... Even for 1975, the production values weren't particularly impressive.
Well, there's a reference to that in film.
It's just a model. Yeah.
It's only a model.
All the castles you see?
Yeah.
It's all the same castle.
Oh, yeah, no. I did see that.
What, just from different angles?
Different angles, from different interiors. Different dressings on the interiors, yeah.
Yeah.
Every single castle, if it's not a model, it's just this one place that...
Yeah, you can tell which ones are models. It's quite obvious.
They were meant
to work filming in a couple of other places, but were basically denied.
Well, I imagine most, if not all of them, were like National Heritage sites.
Yeah.
So they wouldn't be too keen about a bunch of actors and film people coming in and messing things up.
Right, and fact number 5 then. The major knights all have appropriate artwork on their shields and armour.
I knew this one.
Yep.
I actually noticed that.
Yeah. The cowardly Sir Robin has a chicken. Yeah.
Well, let me finish on
and
that.
It's running out of... It's running away from the battle.
Because of the way it's pointing on the shield, it signifies cowardice.
The edge.
Yeah. It's as if it's running away from the battle rather than running towards it. I know. Bedivere, a man of science and nature, has a tree.
Yep.
Lancelot... an overzealous knight that kills without thought, is what I've got written down here, has a rampant griffin emblem, and King Arthur has a symbol depicting the sun.
It's got a mustache on it.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Was that's alluding to his divine quest or divine sponsorship or something?
So, yeah, they all had their own little emblems and stuff like that. And those are the facts. They weren't exactly interesting as far as I'm concerned.
I don't know. I like the one with the shields. I really do quite like the one with the shields.
I like the one about the chicken. I did like that.
I got the chicken one and the cross one.
Yeah.
But not, the others are a bit more vague. like the tree and the sun.
Well, traditionally, the shield is always held in the left hand. So emblems depicting animals have the head facing the right side of the shield. Due to the depiction of it, it means you're charging towards battle.
Yeah, facing towards your sword.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, Sir Robin's is facing away to the left, as if to symbolise cowardice. So
Sir Robin.
And this has been another exciting episode of the Time Warp History Channel.
Sorry. Definitely are doing a historical podcast now.
We really are. Yeah. So, should we get into the film? This was your pick, Andy. So, just why, really? Why? Why?
To be honest,
you knew I hated it. Why?
I actually picked it, partially out of curiosity, because I'd not seen this film in about 20 years. But I used to watch it a lot. I used to absolutely love this film, and I wanted to give it another run and see if it held up.
And did it? Your opinion?
I still enjoyed it.
Okay.
Probably not quite as much as I used to, but it's still loads of silly fun.
I agree with some of that. Loads of silly.
For me, this is for the first time ever I've actually watched one of the Monty Python installments, a brand that I am simultaneously very familiar with and completely ignorant of, because you hear the jokes, you hear about the characters, but I somehow managed to go through my entire life without actually seeing any of it firsthand. So it had quite a high bar going into it. But unfortunately for me, it totally fell flat. I just didn't get the humour. It kind of seemed like Marmite humour to me.
Yes,
you either love it.
I think it has that.
Or you hate it.
Absolutely. I completely agree with what Grant's saying there, because I've tried to watch this film several times. It's a cult classic for a reason. Lots of people really fucking enjoy this one, and I always just watch it and go, that's just not funny.
Like,
oh.
One of the standout scenes was, like, most people have heard of the Knights of Knee.
Yep.
We are the Knights of Knee.
I had no context for this joke, but and I didn't really know what they were, but I've heard of the Knights of Knee, and I've seen people reference the joke. And then I finally see the scene that they're based in, and I'm just like, what?
That's
shrubbery. And knee. I'm just sort of scrunching my face up while I'm watching the screen and just trying to connect the dots of why this is a time-honoured joke, and it's just not happening for me.
Right, we can hear Tom doing quotes in the background. So, Tom, do you like this movie?
I do like this movie. Much like
you
Andy.
You do like bad movies. We've said this before.
We have. Much like Andy, yeah. It's something that I really used to really, really enjoy when I was much younger. Having watched it again for this, it was a case of, maybe not as much as I used to like it. You watch it and you're thinking, this is a little silly. It's something.
A little silly.
It's bonkers. It's really absolutely bonkers.
It's something you do really have to be in the mood for to watch it. You can't just say, I fancy watching a film, I'm going to watch The Holy Grail type thing.
If I fancied watching a film, I would watch a film. And this is one of my bigger problems with this. I am more open to Monty Python's Life of Brian, because I find that has a stronger storyline throughout it.
That is an actual film.
Yeah. It's still got a lot of the silliness about it.
And that is one of my critiques of this.
It's seven skits. Loosely related skits, and there's a small underlying idea. It's not a film. My big problem with this one. It just is not a film.
I like stories.
This does not really have a story.
The plot line of the Holy Grail doesn't even come in until about halfway through. The first half of the film is just Arthur gathering the knights.
Mm. And then they should all go their separate ways so that we could have separate skits of each of them.
I have to completely agree with everything you just said there. Mm-hmm. I was also going to bring up the fact that it didn't feel like a coherent story or a proper constructed narrative based around a single story. It was like a sketch show that had been sewn together. I'll just say it now. God, the animation in this is awful. Yeah, it's so bad, it's almost offensive.
I can't stand
the style. It's not animated. Or it's barely animated at all. It's almost like stop motion animation.
Well, that's what they're going for.
It looks terrible.
I have to agree that the animation looks terrible, but I'm not going to go as bad as Grant, because I did have a little bit more reference for Monty Python. I knew that's what was going to happen.
I wasn't expecting better.
Grant,
I didn't know that. I'm trying to get into the story, and then it suddenly cuts to a little animation skit.
Basically, if you've ever seen the opening title sequence to Monty Python, the Flying Circus, you've got a good
exact
idea of the kind
style.
Of animation that they're using.
I'm talking a lot of this down to just personal dislike here. Too many of the jokes just ran too long. You're waiting for a punchline, and it's too weak, or it never seems to come.
And the one that always gets me with that one is in the Swamp Castle. We've got Lord of the Castle telling the two guards not to let his son out the room.
Yeah,
and
it just, which
it goes on far too long.
I was going to bring that up, and it's a parallel to an earlier scene in the film, the French guards on top of the battlements. John Cleese is talking in a silly French accent, and they're shouting up at him. And this scene's like 3 to 5 minutes long. And
that just, one, I don't feel it so much.
I don't feel it so much. I think the earlier scene where Arthur approaches the castle and they actually have the first conversation about sparrows. But I understand, but I understand where you're coming from.
Are these are some of the more standout ones for me personally, but with the animation where there's that monk sitting at his desk writing and then everything starts bouncing and he walks down the stairs and another set of stairs and another set of stairs.
Okay,
this isn't that long, to be fair, but it's not funny and nothing's happening and it's just stretched out. And just like,
it actually detracts from the film.
Yeah, what is this? What is happening?
It was written by Seth MacFarlane to fill out a Family Guy episode. That is a problem with Family Guy. A lot of the time it drags out a joke just to bump up the runtime, and at one point it was funny, now it's just uncomfortable. Other stuff like randomly breaking the fourth wall without ever paying it off. I think what they walk in and there's a historian at one point basically narrating the ending of it when like the police turns up and starts arresting everybody. It just breaks everything and it's not funny.
Well, the one that really gets me with the fourth wall is Dingo and Castle Anthrax. And it's just the whole do you think this was a good scene? And it's like everyone else from other scenes, just get on with it.
Funnily enough, I think when I used to watch that film, that bit actually was cut out.
There was meant to be a character, I can't remember which one, was meant to be a bit more of a character who literally was going to point out, oh, look, there's a production crew over there and blah blah blah, which was meant to be one of the jokes, and
that
got taken out of it, thank God,
yes,
because
it went through one of the squires.
You mentioned it a few seconds ago, and I also didn't like this. The parallel sections with the modern day, the present, with the police investigation and the historian getting killed. But I thought that was also very jarring and didn't add anything or have any real place in the story.
It was a real shit way to finish it as well.
Yeah.
As an ending, it was not good.
Completely unneeded. Had they just given themselves a proper ending to the story.
Yeah, like finding the Grail, basically.
Just getting killed.
For me, as I already didn't like the first scene with the Frenchman on the battlements, to have another one later in the film obviously fell flat for me. Constructively, I guess things had flown one into the other without too many plot holes, which obviously a problem for more modern films. But then this army just appears out of nowhere, which they hadn't gathered or gotten. This army just appears, and they go back to assault the castle, and then the police show up and arrest them. It's just, not to be too melodramatic, but my reaction to that ending was just, what?
That's it. And that itself went on too long. I was sitting there waiting for this film to end it, and like, I'd paused the bit a couple of times, because I watched it on Netflix, so I paused it a couple of times to see how much longer have I got. Oh, great, there's only a few more minutes. Right. Oh my God, is this still going on? How much longer? Exactly the same amount.
It's like when you keep looking at the clock or your watch, it's like, no way is that only 2 minutes have passed.
Yeah, I have that at work.
Right.
I think maybe I had too high expectations going into this, because it's the legendary Monty Python. Going in thinking, oh, I'm going to get some like laugh out loud moments here. I'm going to be giggling and like, this is going to be great. I'm going to see, the Black Knight scene in its proper context and all this stuff. And then just nothing came together for me really quickly.
Maybe that was part of the problem. You know of all of these scenes.
You've had all this hype.
And you expect because you've never found them funny before, you expect if you put them into their proper scene and you get the context right, it's suddenly going to make sense. And then you realise, no, actually, I already knew everything.
Pretty much.
And just not necessarily in the right order.
Morgan and Wise, fucking love them. And this was one of the things I was worried about when you mentioned this, is that I've seen most of this film before. I've seen pretty much all of the scenes done before and done better in fucking Lego.
Yeah, but everything's better in Lego.
You go onto YouTube and you've got Grant's favourite part of the movie where they suddenly start singing. When you see it done in Lego, it is good.
Really? Yeah. Really? That's a stretch.
Actually, no, I'll be honest. I like that song because I do kind of like Monty Python songs.
Even the characters in the film thought the Camelot song was so bad that they weren't going to go to Camelot after all.
Yeah, or at least not go to Camelot. It's a silly place.
Yeah. But no, I didn't like the songs, but that's more on me. I don't like most songs. Yeah.
He doesn't like musicals.
I don't like musicals. The only musicals I can really stomach are some Disney films.
Right. Me and him have been very negative for a bit. Let's hear you two be a bit positive. You know, let's try and have a rounded podcast. And we'll probably shout you down going, no, that was shit.
These two don't stand a chance against us.
They don't.
No, probably not.
Probably why we sat there not.
I would just like to, obviously, we are sitting here giving a very negative, you know, all the reasons we don't like it. There's two people sat here who do like it, so let's hear some reasons. You know, is it just nostalgia? Is it because Andy's really old, so 70s humour?
I think there is an element of
there's
nostalgia.
There's definitely a chunk of nostalgia.
I expect Andy, like me, has been watching it since he was knee-high to a grasshopper.
I think I first saw it when I was about 12 or something like that.
I haven't heard that phrase in about 30 years.
Yeah, I think I first saw it when I was about 12 or something like that, and I used to watch it quite a lot.
It's like a lot of films that we all enjoy from our childhood. We like them because there was something we grew up watching.
And grew up with other people who watched it as well. So there was also that sort of...
Yeah.
Yeah, the quotability that...
Oh, absolutely, because I've been on the internet. Yeah. I've seen quotes from this film all over the place. It definitely has its following.
Yeah, a film that has a lot of lines, or at least a few core lines, that are, you know, supremely quotable, really adds to its appeal.
Yeah. And so, yeah, so I also grew up with people who also watched it and loved it. So there was a lot of... sort of a communal thing going on there as well.
I think you've covered quite strongly what your appeal, both of your main appeal is nostalgia, which is not a bad thing at all.
Yeah, oh, no.
Just because...
I love some really bad movies just because I saw them when I was a kid.
What is a lot of what we're about?
Nostalgia.
Nostalgia. That's what so much of our enjoyment is derived from. And, you know, what's been going on the last decade and a half?
Very much.
Reboots of 80s and 90s films and bringing back so much stuff from previous decades.
And because Netflix and streaming has made it so accessible to have all of the stuff that we watched when we were kids.
Now you can actually watch the original stuff from when we were kids, but have to hunt through the nethers, you know, the darkest regions of the internet to buy it.
I've had this conversation, though, with people before, you know. Say, our parents' generation, once they got to a certain age, like they had TV and they had programs that they watched, but when they got to a certain age, those shows were no longer on, and they had to give up those elements of their like past and of their childhood. Whereas our generation seems to be the first that never had to give it up. It's pretty much always there, always available to us.
Yeah, that's true.
And I think that's what's kept it alive and kept 80s nostalgia, 90s nostalgia, in a few years, noughties nostalgia, which I really can't get my head around. But it's going to be happening.
Just wrong.
We're how old?
Exactly. Exactly. And this is why pop culture, although it kind of started in the 50s, it definitely, you know, matured in the 80s and 90s. And like I say, we are the first generation that hasn't had to give up all those things that we loved as kids unless we've held on to it from when we were kids.
Mm.
It is just there. Mm. It's accessible. You can come up with any obscure cartoon. Go onto YouTube. You'll find it.
Well, 99%.
I'm going to have to test that with a new schmoo.
So nostalgia is, as we say, a very powerful influence on all of us. Luckily for me, I never saw this film when I was younger.
What do you mean, luckily? You might have enjoyed it. I might have enjoyed it.
I don't think I would have. It's not a film. I'm sorry, it's not a film.
Actually, I think one of the other things that plays into this, why we perhaps like it, is Monty Python doing what they do best, taking the piss out of stuff. You know, they take the piss out of sort of clerics of the medieval time, knights, peasants. The whole fact that, you know, actually, I mean, one of the early scenes is all about the fact that we're a kingdom. We're ruled by a singular ruler, and you've got characters in there bringing up democracy and...
Oh, yeah, that first scene. I bet that went over the head of the majority of the people that watched that.
Probably.
Because I didn't particularly follow all of it.
But it's things like that. They're just taking the piss out of it. And people like it when you take the piss out of stuff. Especially if it's something that...
Well, up until he met Bedivere...
Loving ribbing.
Yeah.
Up until he met Bedivere, nobody knew who he was. I'm your king. Who?
Yeah.
I didn't vote for him.
I didn't. So, my king?
We haven't done enough quotes from the movie, you know.
Is it possible? Yeah.
It's Monty Python. There should be a certain amount of quotes that you have to get in. I think it's the fucking law. So there's one of them. Knee. There's another.
We like to say knee.
Yeah.
We want you to find us a shrubbery.
Of all the jokes in the film, that completely came out of left field. I would never have guessed that's where that joke was heading. A
She's
shrubbery.
A She's a witch. She turned me into a newt.
A newt?
I got better.
Bedivere with his faceplate constantly holding it up like it was a pair of shades or something.
Yeah. There's sorts of little things, though, that sort of just, you know, you notice for a little bit and you're thinking, yeah, it's actually kind of funny, and then forget about because it's just constantly happening. So it's either, either forget about it or it just grates on you.
It kind of grated.
it grates.
Puns intended.
No. I'm really struggling to say anything more about this.
Yeah, it's Marmite, isn't it?
Yeah,
pretty much.
I think that is very much it.
It is very
a lot of the internet that's going to listen to this are probably going to hate us.
Well, they're going to hate you too. They're going to love me.
I don't really mind. I really don't on this. I just couldn't get into it. I've never been a huge fan of Monty Python. There is an episode of The Simpsons where somebody is forced to watch all the other God knows how many hours of Monty Python that aren't funny. You know, because everybody just quotes the like dead parrot sketch and lumberjack song and stuff like that. Everybody knows the core, the Black Knight, the knights that say knee. But there is so much more Monty Python out there that really just fell flat and forgotten
about. This was me going into it.
Yeah.
I'm aware of all the famous stuff and I'm thinking the rest of the material must be, you know,
must be just as good.
Just as good or possibly as good. And then obviously when I went in and saw it, I was just really confused and a bit baffled by...
Apparently he doesn't like the Holy Angrin of Antioch. You know, I wouldn't have to consult the Book of Armaments. Chapter 2, verses 9 through 21.
Nothing doing there.
you know when you really...
The fact that they take the chant from the monks earlier in the film, which is Pie Jesu Domine Donna... I can't even remember it now.
No, I just want to describe to anybody listening to this, because I wish I was fucking videoing this. Like, the look of exasperation on Tom's face as he's trying to explain this, and the blank reception he's getting from Grant.
This is the face I had while I was watching the film.
It's just... I really wish I was videoing this.
Sorry, it's one of those things. That is actually a religious chant. It's... basically translates as "Pious Lord Jesus, grant them rest." What is it basically saying? It's "Please Lord, make it stop."
God, yeah, I understand that sentiment.
I can relate to that.
Yeah, but I'll be honest, I was thinking that when they do the first fucking joke with the subtitles or the credits at the beginning.
Yeah, it's not great.
And with the fake Swedish.
Yeah.
Fake Swedish. Yeah, which ends up being when they've got an Oriental narrator into it at the end of it, because then they have the Chinese restaurant, don't they?
Yeah, see, it's just falling flat for you two now. Oh yeah, they have that bit, don't they? They
ruined it for us now.
No, I've literally got nothing left to say on this one.
No, I don't want to harp on against it too much. I didn't like it. It didn't work for me. Fair enough.
Well, if you read some of the stuff on, especially on IMDb, it didn't really work for the guys doing the film either. They rate it as their worst film.
They do rate Monty Python and Life of Brian as their best.
Yeah.
See, Jay mentioned Life of Brian at the beginning. Why don't you pick that, Andy? Why pick this as my introduction to Monty Python? You know, you've poisoned the well before I've even drunk the water.
This is the one that had my nostalgia buttons pressed.
He wants to know if you've been to the Castle Anthrax.
I literally could not watch Life of Brian or anything else now because I'd be taking my tainted viewpoint right into it.
Unfortunately, I don't think you would like Life of Brian. It's very similar in terms of the type of humour.
Yeah.
But it's better. It is a more coherent story.
Coherent story.
There is a definite plot to it and you follow
it. It's not just random sketches which are loosely connected.
Something at least.
It's an actual full, you know.
Meaning of Life, meanwhile, is much more a sketch thing.
Oh, that literally is sketches.
And it's meant to be. This one, unfortunately, to me, just didn't really know what it was trying to be. Was it meant to be a sketch or was it meant to be a film? And it fucked up both. Okay, so we're basically settled on this is a Marmite movie that you're either going to love or hate. There is no real middle ground to it.
No, there isn't.
Seems like
agreed.
I'll be honest, I was talking to someone at work the other day and quite randomly they started quoting this movie and they bloody loved it. And they looked at me like I just stabbed their mum when I went, I watched that the other day, it is shit. You know, so...
Get out.
Yeah. So, that's Monty Python and the Holy Grail. And I am quite happy to say that I will never watch that again.
Same here. Probably no other Monty Python stuff either. It's just not for me.
No.
And now we'll never know the flight speed, velocity, and unladen sparrow.
I didn't care.
What do you mean, African or European?
I don't know.
That joke was just awful when they were talking about the coconuts and the string and
at the beginning, that was like, one of the really
that wasn't just not scenes. Funny. It was negative funny. It was so unfunny. It just sapped any potential giggles from out of your soul.
But it's a trademark Monty Python. They never really hit a punchline. They just kind of trailed into something else.
Yeah,
just ramble on.
Yeah, sketches just end. There is no definite to a lot of them. It just ends or it'll go into a new scene.
The two runners, they are not.
Yeah. Anyway, that was Andy's pick, and I'm quite happy to say that it's my pick now. You know, last person to pick.
Based.
Yay. What?
Based.
What?
Current internet slang for bias.
What?
What?
I'm happy.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
He's happy that it's his pick.
Well, of course he is. He gets to pick.
We've just had two podcasts where I haven't particularly enjoyed the film. I know I'm going to enjoy the next one. You know, and I'm going to break what we've done because we've had, like, RoboCop, the great action thriller. We've had science fiction, and we've had shit. So I'm going to go with comedy.
Ooh.
I see what you did there.
Yeah.
There was fighting words. And yeah. You've seen this. He's throwing shade, man.
I am, definitely. No, I'm going to go with classic comedy from the 80s, Dan Aykroyd, Eddie Murphy, and Trading Places.
Never seen that.
Well, then you're in for a treat, maybe.
Slag it off now.
do you like Dan Aykroyd?
Yeah, I like Dan Aykroyd.
Then you will like this film.
Do you like Dan Aykroyd? Do you like Eddie Murphy? Do you like the 80s?
You will like this film. It's pretty much a slam dunk.
I'm hoping you will. Anyway. He's building it up too much now.
I know.
Yeah. Now I'm going to have to change it.
Uh-oh.
The bars are pissed.
But as I say, that'll be next time on Time Warp Cinema, Trading Places. And that's pretty much the end of this episode. So all that's left for me to say is thank you for listening to the Time Warp Cinema podcast. We hope you enjoyed. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and come say hi over on Twitter at @TimeWarp_cinema. Join us again in 2 weeks when we revisit Trading Places and discuss our favourite Brad Pitt performances. So from me, Tom, Grant and Andy, we say goodbye, and strange women lying in ponds distributing swords is no basis for a system of government.
Help! Help! Yeah. I'm being repressed!
We're knights at our table, we dance where we're able. We do routines, recorder scenes, to footwork impeccable. We dine well here in Camelot, we eat ham and jam and spam a lot. Knights of the Round Table, our shows are for mid-able. The many times we give and rhyme, that are quite unsing able. We're off from mad in Camelot, we sing from the diaphragm alone.